start, right?
Records, oh, it's record, yeah.
Right? It's mm-hmm. recording. It keeps on it. Record.
Okay, perfect.
And then you press.
All right, welcome everybody. Thanks for coming out of the steamy November weather to make it here today. So we are here for Jonathan David Smyth, his book release in the back for sale by that handsome gentleman. It's his first monograph, Just One More, Self-Portraits, 2012 to 2017. So just a bit about Jonathan. He's an artist. He works with photography, video, performance, and incorporated text. He was born in Belfast, and he recently attended Parsons School of Design, where he obtained his MFA in photography in 2014. Smyth has exhibited in galleries and venues in the United States and abroad. He currently lives here in New York City. And he will be joining Michelle Dunn Marsh in conversation. Dunn Marsh is an advocate for significant photography and the printed page. She held positions with the Aperture Foundation and Chronicle Books before co-founding Minor Matter Books with Steve McIntyre. She joined this Photographic Center for the Northwest as executive director in August 2013. So she's lectured at Parsons and the New School, Yale University, and the University of Washington, among others. She's also the chair of the photography panel for Young Arts in Miami. So I'm gonna give it over to you guys. Thanks so much, Nancy. And welcome. Thank you for joining us on this balmy November evening. I'm very excited to be here with Jonathan. This is a dream come true on many levels for both of us. So we are glad that you can be a part of this conversation. So I'm gonna pose a couple of questions to this young man to get the conversation going. And then we will also welcome conversations from or questions from some of you as we get to that point of the evening. So for those of you who are not familiar with Just One More, this is a brand new monograph by BE Studios, and Rob is selling copies in the back, and Jonathan will be personalizing copies after our conversation. So let's just start out with you making photographs. So tell us about when you first picked up a camera.
Hello. I like using a microphone.
There might be a Cyndi Lauper rendition at the end of this conversation. I'm just warning you all.
Or a Spice Girl.
Or a Spice Girl.
Yes, it could happen.
I am a Spice Girl. The first photograph I ever took was, I was looking into my flatbed scanner. I didn't have a camera. That was the first one. It was a bit weird.
Was it of your face?
It was of my face, this kind of portion here.
You saw your reflection in the glass and decided that you needed to capture that in some way?
I think that someone asked for my photograph on some AOL chat room. Which, you know, of the time. You know, that was of the time. And I remember this self-portrait that I took with a flatbed scanner, because I didn't have a digital camera, which digital camera was like a new thing at that point. I didn't have one.
Right.
You know, to instantly get this photograph of myself to whoever it was I was talking to.
So it's safe to say that the beginnings of your life in photography were very closely tied to an idea of self-representation.
Yes.
So when did you decide that the camera was a tool of the language that you were interested in speaking?
That came a little bit after. When I took the flatbed scanner portrait, I must have been about 12 or 13. I went to what you would call in America a community college to do photography when I was 16. And you know, you learn to photograph these kind of traditional things when you're learning photography. So it was a lot of buildings, and then there was sort of like people, portraiture and stuff. And then I started to think, well, actually, maybe I should start photographing my family life, because that was something that I find difficult to talk about. So if I could take a photograph and show people, then it was almost like a bit sort of, like I could prove my point.
So for those people here who don't know you as well, can you talk a little bit about your family life and why it was something that you weren't necessarily talking about? And tell us first and foremost where you grew up, because your background and my background has at least an island in common, if not borders.
I was born in Belfast, Northern Ireland. I was brought up in a small town called Larne, which is on the coast of Northern Ireland. I was adopted. Me and my sister were adopted together, and it was a foster family. So I had two other sisters who were fostered, and then I had this blood sister. So there was the four of us together, and it was a foster family, but we didn't call ourselves that. But we also didn't really talk openly about how different that was compared to most of the people that I knew. So, you know, being adopted was something that I never had a problem talking about, but I felt, I was made to feel, perhaps, that I wasn't allowed to tell people. So I would lie about it, you know. And some of the lies were silly.
Like what?
I would make up that I knew where my real father was, but he actually maybe lived in Hollywood. And he was picking me up at the weekend, stuff like that. I would have fun with it, but then I did get to the point where it was annoying me. And then I was gay on top of all of that. So photography became this thing that I was able to use to tell these stories, you know, in a way that it made it easier for me to show people.
I know that some of your earliest work that I was familiar with had to do with your family and video pieces, I'm Telling on You piece, but at what point were you making images of yourself at that time also? I mean, when you started with photography, was there a component of self-portraiture in your early studies in photography?
No, actually that's a really important question. There wasn't any sort of self-portraiture for a long time. I would actually say this project, just one more, it's 5 years old, I would say that was a huge turning point for me to actually photograph myself. Because believe it or not, I am a shy person. I'm not. But I didn't, when I first got into photography and all of that, I wouldn't have had the nerve to photograph myself. I wouldn't have felt comfortable. So it was other people. It was what I was seeing. It was what I was seeing. I was seeing my parents and my sisters and my nieces and nephews. And maybe I was seeing them. And maybe sometimes I couldn't, I didn't feel part of whatever it was that was happening in front of me. So there was already kind of some sort of, distance. So then the camera became this thing that I could actually use to maybe look through this thing and, you know, capture.
The image that is in the introduction of you and your mother, where the camera is almost entirely obscuring your face. I mean, essentially it looks like the camera with your hair behind it. Were you seeing that in that moment as a self-portrait, or were you actually trying to photograph your mother and the reflection became an afterthought?
That was one, the photograph you're talking about, it's called Peeling. That was one that, it was years later. It was actually my husband who saw it, because I had hidden it away.
Thank you, Rob.
I had hidden it away. And it was one of those things where you see it a while after you've taken it and you realize maybe what it could mean. But in the moment, I was probably trying to photograph just my mother.
So you were studying photography. You were also working quite early in video. So can you speak for a moment about the moving image versus the still image? Because I think as we move then into what does it mean to make photographs with something that is not a camera, or didn't start out being a camera, there is an inherent motion to the idea of a mobile phone, cell phone. And so I'm curious to hear a little bit from you about your own progression or relationship, I would say, with both the still and the moving image. Can you talk about that a little bit?
The moving image allowed me to kind of come out of myself more because I was in it. And I made a documentary when I still lived in Britain in 2010, I'm telling on you. And I'm in that documentary and it's a moving image, but it's not really about me, it's about my family, and I kind of narrate and kind of talking about making the work. But when I moved to New York, it felt like I was starting over. And in a way, it was like coming out all over again, because I could wear crop tops, short shorts. I could wear whatever I wanted, I could say whatever I wanted, I could be myself completely, and I really felt that way. So I wanted to capture myself in this city, and that became performance videos. I was performing, I've always wanted to be a movie star.
Well, I think that speaks to an inclination that we're seeing culturally in the combination of social media and the constant availability of the camera. And you and I were having this conversation, and in 2015 I curated an exhibition with a couple of other people in Seattle called Me and My Selfie. And one of the starting premises for that was, how are we defining a selfie versus self-portraiture, which of course has been a part of the history of art, and certainly the history of photography for a long time. And a woman named Susie Lee, who's an incredible artist and very forward-thinking person, was the one who articulated for me that the distinction of a selfie is the act of sharing it immediately through some form of social media. And that was a 21st century notion, that you could disperse something instantly that you had captured. And though we started with that exhibition thinking that the selfie was going to contain multitudes, pretty much everything came down to documentation and or. Your series is both documentation and self-expression, and quite, I will say, a love letter to New York City. So can you talk a little bit about your desire to move to New York and then arriving here, and how that informs what became this 5-year series?
It was an obsession, New York, for me. Well, America was an obsession. It was something I kind of always wanted to do the things that people told me I couldn't do, and New York was the biggest of that.
I think a lot of people come here for that reason.
Right, and I find that. And I've never, that feeling has never went away. I mean, I have days where I'm having a bad day, right? Or when I hit someone on the street, whatever it is. But I still love New York, and I wouldn't be anywhere else, and I'm happy here. And I wanted to photograph myself in this place that I really did fantasize about, My father took me to see Home Alone 2 in the cinema. I was a kid, and he took me again the next day because I laughed so much. And I remember after that, that was an obsession. New York was an obsession. And I just find a way to get here.
So how did you get here? And why did you end up here? That's where we met, so you should give Parsons a little shout out.
Parsons School of Design. Is really how I got here. I was doing a master's in photography, and Michelle was one of my teachers. And we bonded instantly, quite instantly, with an instant photograph, actually, if I remember correctly. Right?
I think I photographed the class with the Instax, if I remember. And this was a course on photography, technology, and culture. So that was appropriate. At what point, so you are capturing yourself in this new place, in this place that you've dreamed about. Was there a moment where you were realizing that you are now turning the camera upon yourself? And were you seeing yourself in a new way as a result of that?
I became more confident. I would say when I first did it, you know, Instagram was new. That was a new thing. That's where they first appeared. I still post them on Instagram, I'm still taking them. But Instagram was new back then, and there wasn't a lot of people that really knew about it, and they were going on there as kind of these experiments. And I was really just posting them. I wasn't really thinking about them as a series or even as self-portraits. Then there was a turning point where I had to gather them together. It was for the exhibit at Photographic Center Northwest that you were talking about. It was for that. That was a real turning point where I had to decide, I think, 20 of them. You know, and at that point it was 3 years or something like that. And I had to go through, you know, I had to go through iPhoto, grabbing, you know, this sort of archive of, and I remember thinking what they meant then. It was different. But they're self-portraits, but they're, you know, they're as much about where I am and the time of day. And
I think that was a distinctive element when, from the other side of the exhibition equation, we were gathering images.
Yeah.
And it became obvious very quickly that there were a very few number of people who were working using a cell phone, making selfies, but with a much deeper and more interesting aesthetic end result than the majority of the global population. And so the inundation of often uninteresting, badly composed, poorly lit, more bathrooms and kitchens and plates of food, including some part of someone's head, than I could care to count. Right? If your photographs actually were suddenly, it was, you know, people from the press were coming in trying to figure out how to say something, and they were very happy that your series was there because it gave them something to speak about that was photographic. In a way that the majority of what we were seeing as a selfie were not, in many ways. So you have 2 years ago, you have this moment where maybe this is a series. How, or does that change in any way your process of then making the photographs? Do you think about them any differently? Did it change how you saw them? Did it change how you saw yourself?
Yes. You don't want to take away the organicness of how I take them, which is none of them are planned. And they are taken as I'm going somewhere or, you know, leaving somewhere. Like, I never say, oh, I'm going to go there and take a photo. It's just, and this is the beauty of it, I always have my phone with me, so. But when I realized that it was a series and I was going to do this and I was going to keep doing this, yes, it does change it. I take it more seriously. They mean a lot to me, these photographs. I spend a lot of time looking at them and considering them, and drive my husband crazy sitting there with the phone. Because it's all on the phone. You know, I don't sort of take them and then drag them to my computer or anything. It's all on the phone. So, yeah.
So let's hope you're backing it up on a regular basis.
I do back it up.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what happens when something that has emerged out of a movable communications device turns into a book? What is that process? How did this book come to be?
The book.
That's what we're discussing here today.
The book. book. This is the book. The publisher slash designer, Book Kurtis, was familiar with the photographs from Instagram. And that was a conversation, a very short conversation that we had at the Rainbow Book Fair a couple of years ago, which then became an email, which then became a coffee, which then became let's do a book together. Also, I feel like I love books, and I love the physicality of actually having a book and holding a book. And there was talk about doing a digital sort of Kindle version, but I wanted to get them away from, I wanted to see them somewhere else other than a screen, you know. I wanted a volume, and they look different printed as well. I also wanted to collaborate and have someone write about the work. That's you.
And Dana.
And Dana, who I have a conversation with in the book. And I love this kind of, I love the fact that I have these people in the book whom I really admire, and I'm very, very proud that they wanted to be a part of this. So that was also another big part of having a book.
It was an exciting opportunity, and I was very flattered when you asked me to write. I think it would have been extremely challenging if I had not thought about this through the form of the exhibition and understanding how do we look at contemporary culture through an art historical lens. How do we start to apply the thinking of an analysis of something that is surrounding us all the time. And in the process of evaluating that with the exhibition, it brought me to places of clarity in what made the series that you were doing different. Because ultimately then I have to come back to, how do I feel about this as a photograph? And is it interesting as a photograph? And why? Is it something that I will come back to see again? And so when I took your series, which had one level of evaluation in the exhibition, i.e. they needed to be selfies, and that was essentially the only bar. When you said, I'm doing a book of this, and will you write about it, I had to put them through another filter of, now this is a book. And the filter for this being a book for me is a different filter. Now they have to function as photographs. And so it was exciting to go through that process with you and look at the images. And I think I said, yes, and send me a selection of images. Mm-hmm. Because the book is a form we value, and the book is what will last. We don't know what will happen with these pixels. But the book is something that we know will be there. And so the opportunity to gather them together and to consider them in another way that is in many ways a more traditional sort of taking them out of their modern context, right? And in some ways putting them back in time while at the same time allowing them to be what they are. And as you said, that you still put them on Instagram. You didn't remove them from the context that you've been experiencing them in. So. How did it feel to make a book? What were the hardest parts? What were the most phenomenal parts?
I mean, I feel that it's still a brand new thing in my life. I mean, this book really only was finished about a month ago. But
this is its birthday today.
Yeah, it's a special day. I mean, it also exists as a digital slideshow, which is behind me. So there's sort of there's the digital slideshow. Now we have the glorious book, and they're still on Instagram and other sort of screens in that sense that you can access. The hardest part about the book was probably picking the images, because we're talking hundreds, you know, it's 5 years worth of taking. And that is where they lived on my bedroom wall. For about 6 or 7 months, I printed about 1,000 at FedEx. cut them out.
Printing is not something your generation does very often. Just printing.
That's true. Yeah, but then even to sort of have them, and then it's, you know, harking back to sticking posters on my walls, and it became really fun in this other kind of in the middle kind of exhibits of this work.
And it was all you. All your Hollywood star dreams came true.
And then, you know, my husband he's actually Robert Ritter. He's actually the associate photo editor, and he really is, because he really helped me look at these photographs. And so I would say that was the hardest part about the book, actually picking the photographs. The best part about the book is this, and being able to share it with people, because that was really what I wanted to do. I wanted people to see this work.
That seems like a great transition to, does anyone in our audience have questions for Jonathan? Or me, but really, let's get real. This is about Jonathan. Yes?
Well, first, huge congratulations. I'm wondering if you could talk about, these are selfies, and almost all of them, the self is to different degrees dissolved. Sometimes it's dissolved entirely. And at the beginning, you were talking about some kind of earlier bodies of work dealing with autobiography and ways that you conceal, and if you, I'm curious if you draw any kind of relationship between those two.
Good question, Robert Marshall. Yeah, if you want to get really, really deep, let's go deep. Layering. I'm photographing my reflection, and that is what I'm doing. I'm photographing my reflection, I'm in the reflection. It's me taking a photograph of myself. As an adopted person, as a gay person, as an immigrant, there's connotations there. There's you know, I'm very, that doesn't have to be something that you see or know when you look at the photographs, but that is something that I consider with it as a body of work, you know. Sometimes I like being less obvious, so that it's almost like a secret, you know. But not everyone knows. But yeah, it's an important part when I'm taking them.
Other questions? Yes.
Congratulations, Jonathan, first of all. I'm wondering what your actual opinion is on the selfie. Kind of as you were mentioning earlier, you know, we're all kind of used to either the bathroom selfie or the poorly lit one, or usually just very, you know, outfit of the day, gratuitous picture of yourself. And you, intentionally or not, have really kind of removed yourself from that, yet it's still a selfie. And I'm just wondering, like, when you're scrolling through Instagram, like, what goes through your mind when you encounter those, you know, those basic kinds of selfies that we're all used to?
I actually really like it. I like seeing what other people take. Some are better than others. Some I want to see more than others. I actually went to, on the subject of the selfie, I went to Barnes & Noble when Kim Kardashian released her book, and I was sickened. But I sat there in the section where you don't buy the book, but you can read it, the free bit. And I really sat down and I really said to myself, okay, I'm going to really consider this. And I couldn't do it. Like, I really tried, but that's okay. They can exist, it can exist, she can exist. You know, what angered me the most about her, about that book, was the fact that there was handwriting in it, but it was a font. It was a handwriting font. So, yeah. But yeah, I like seeing what other people do in that way, with the kind of selfie, you know.
I think the notion of authenticity and construction becomes a very interesting one in an extremely democratic way, right? That there are people, I mean, Jonathan has been trained to think about imagery, and so in some ways it's inherent that you would apply that. At the same time, there are a lot of people who are very sophisticated in image making who still make really quite banal documentation of themselves to say, I'm in this place at this time with these people, right? And so I do find that interesting, and I think we are still so much in the midst of it that it's gonna be what we can say about this now, and then what gets said a decade from now is still going to shift and change. There was another question.
Yeah, I was gonna say that I've recently become aware that the selfie is a way of documenting that you are in a certain place. Like, I was in, last fall, I was in Venice, and Venice gets something like 25 million visitors a year, and it felt like every single one of them had a selfie stick. So when someone said about, well, we have the bathroom selfie or the kitchen selfie, I kept thinking, well, that's not how I think about selfies now. Now I think about selfies as you take a selfie of yourself in front of the pyramids, in front of the Grand Canal, in front of the Taj Mahal. Mm-hmm. So it's this idea that, you know, it proves that you are there, but you're there by yourself, basically. And you can have someone else share the selfie with you, but it used to be where you'd have to either bring along, at one point you'd have to bring along a professional photographer to photograph you and all of these exotic places, because travel was much more difficult to do. And now we've gotten to the point where you can photograph yourself in these exotic places all by yourself.
It's true, but that also harkens so directly back to the history of photography, which is why Francis Frith's photographs were popular, right? Because it showed people something that, whether they had been there or not, those who had been there would purchase these photographs or eventually postcards. Sure. But I think we've come full circle that actually you can say you're in a variety of places in the world on social media without actually being there. So I could tag us in Venice right now. And that has nothing to do with reality. And so I think those relationships and going back to, you know, the verisimilitude of photography, the appearance of truth, without there actually needing to be any truth there. But Jonathan's work, and the thing that I noticed the most when the edit was in book form was not so much him, it was New York. It was this repeated sort of love affair, not so much of himself, right? Because you are there, but you are obscured in many cases, but of this place. And that was something that stood out to me specifically when it was in book form that I thought was interesting. There was another question.
Oh, this isn't stopping.
So this is just one more. So this is just volume one.
I think so. I mean, I just wouldn't like to be so presumptuous to think that my, you know, publisher would want to do another effort, so maybe another 5 years. Maybe, who knows, we'll still have books. I don't know what's going to happen.
You will still have books.
I hope so.
But Charlie Rubin, who's sitting here, has at least 3 editions of Strange Paradise, so you can just continue to add, change, alter, adjust.
Hello. Sorry. I don't see myself stopping. I don't think I'll ever stop. And I like that. I like that idea that I actually don't know when it's going to stop. it's become part of my life, and it's documented parts of my life that are very important. You know, you might not see it if you look at some of the photographs, but I know that I took one on the day after I got married. You know, I know that there's one in there that I took, the very first one I ever took when I came to New York. But also, we're documenting, through this, we're documenting places in New York that actually now don't exist anymore. You know, it's 5 years, and a lot of the places in the book have changed or aren't there anymore. So, to answer your question from before better, that has also changed my sort of taking of the photographs and the series in general, because it's now become about sort of archiving as well.
I think this is a moment I want to say Daniel Williams' name out loud.
Daniel Williams, 30 today. So my best friend, he passed away a few years ago. Today would have been his 30th birthday, and we're having the event today, and the book is dedicated to him. So we should do a round of applause for Daniel Williams.
Yeah. I think this is a great moment to send Jonathan to the back table for all of you who would like to buy a copy of Just One More and have any further questions or conversations with him there so he can sign it for you.
Sure.
Thank you so much for coming. Thank you.
Thank you. Before that, I just want to say thanks so much to Michelle Dunn Marsh. I can't tell you, thanks enough. I love you. I love you so much. Thank you for doing this. I also want to thank Dana Stirling, who has been recording. And Dana also we have a conversation together in the book. So Dana and I talk together in the book. And I want to thank Jefferson Market Library for letting me have this. I mean, this is a dream in itself, just having this here. And lastly, I want to thank my husband. For helping so much with this. He really has. He's at the back with the glasses. He's incredibly good looking at the back with glasses. And thank you all for coming.
So it might just be the preview.
Yeah.
On the screen, you know what I mean?
Well, it's